Good morning, everybody. Welcome, welcome. Do come and find a seat and we'll make a start this morning. Oh, lovely to see everyone. Wow, well, lovely, really lovely to see everybody. Lovely to see you guys. And we've got some visitors, so the Allisons, welcome to you all. Florence, Freddie, Henry, Emily, Charlie. Yes, nice to see you guys. Hope you feel really warm and welcome this morning. I'm really glad to have you with us. Keith and Christine, congratulations. Keith and Christine got married last weekend. Last weekend?
Yes.
Yes. All going well. Bless the Lord. Well, yeah, thrilled for you guys. So that's absolutely wonderful. And Yvonne, lovely to see you again. Marvellous. And Graham. So welcome, Graham. Graham's coming to preach for us today. So we're really glad to have you here with us, Graham. My name is Jan. I'll just lead us a little bit this morning, and then I'll be handing over to Graham, who's going to preach to us later. So if anybody needs facilities during the service, through that door at the back and turn right, and the toilets will be ahead of you there. If you're able to, while you're inside, then do wear a mask. We will be wearing them definitely when we're singing. So when we're singing, please put a mask on. That's just going to reduce the amount of our sort of breath projecting around the room. So that'll help keep everyone safe from COVID. If you need to, while you're sat down, to take it off briefly, that's fine. But it's safer if we can sustain it. Lovely. Yeah. So, well, let me pray, and then we've got some cards to hand out and some songs to sing. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for another Sunday where we can meet together. Thank you for another day where we can come and praise you and worship you and do this together this morning. We pray that you would come and meet with us. Jesus, we're so thankful for what you've done for us, for dying on the cross and rising again to life. Risen Lord, we want to sing about you this morning, and so all our songs are just going to be praising and focusing on you. And so we ask, Holy Spirit, that you come and open our hearts, warm our hearts this morning to praise and worship you as we should. Lord, for anyone here who's inquisitive, who's thinking about these things, we ask that you would meet with them in a really special way this morning, that they would see Jesus and know him as their risen Saviour, the one who is alive. So God, we ask that you be pleased with our worship to you this morning, our prayers, our singing, our thoughts, whatever it is, the preaching, Lord, we ask that it would be a real sweet, sweet sound to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This morning we have some songs that we're going to sing, and they're all about Jesus. I'm really excited to be singing these songs, and there's all these words to do with Jesus and who he is. So he is faithful, it says here. Sarah's coming round and she's got some cards for you guys, okay? And they all say different things. Now, during the song, when we sing the word that you've got, what we want you to do is come up here and attach it to our, we've got our cross on the floor here. Okay. So you're gonna stick it on there. So while we're singing, then you've got to be listening out for your word that you've got. And when you hear it, do come up, stick it on the cross here, and at the end we'll see everything we've got. Is that a question, Vivian? Oh no, you're sorry. For Jenny. Thank you. Hi everybody, welcome, welcome, coming in. Ready, Graham? And we'll, great, well, yeah, so we'll pop our masks on, we'll stand up to sing, and we're going to sing two songs to begin with. Jesus is the King, and our God is a great big God. So do stand up and sing.
Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hand. Our God.
Wonderful, wonderful. Great. So how are we doing with this? Great, we've got a bit more to go now. It's lovely. Graham, do you want to come on up? This is the first time that Graham has been here with us. So we've got some questions that I'm going to ask Graham, but actually it's a quiz for you guys. How well do we really know Graham? So I want to ask Graham, can you take this one?
Yes, okay. Am I all right with the mask?
Can I use this one?
Yeah. Too many Grahams.
Two Grahams, that's right. Testing. I need to leave. Anything?
Oh, sorry, if I actually turn the right one on. Whoa,
Tiger! Okay, good. Well, so this is a quiz. Obviously, we found out your name is Graham. Welcome.
Thank you.
Now, Graham has some children, okay, and I want you guys to guess. How many children do you think Graham has? Look at him. How many children does it look like this man has had? Okay, so I'm going to give you... is it one, two... or three? It's quite obvious he's had at least one. Okay, so, right, hands up for one.
Oh, wow.
Hands up for two. Hands up for three. Graham, would you like to reveal?
Yeah, I have three children.
Yeah! Well done. Do you want to tell us a little bit about your three children?
They're all grown up now. One is away in Cambridgeshire doing an apprenticeship and internship in a church there. The other two are still at home. One is working at the hospital and one is working in Oxford. Two girls, the oldest are girls, Lizzie and Susie, and my son is Micah. And there we go.
Very good. Okay, so the other thing we need to know about Graham is that he used to be a teacher. Would you believe it? So, look at this man again. He's at secondary school, he's at a big school. And we're going to work out which subject we think this man used to teach.
Hey.
So, hands... I'm going to give you three options. So, one is maths. Two is... art.
That's not the one.
And three is history. So, hands up for maths. Hands up for art. Hands up for history. Graham, would you like to reveal it?
Yeah, well, I do love history. And I'm sure I talked very artistically, but I was a maths teacher.
And so you should tell us about where you were teaching it.
Yeah, I taught in a comprehensive school in the north part of Derby. It was a good time. I was only there for 5 years, which seemed like a long time at the time, but I appreciate for those others of you who've been teaching for a long time, that's nothing at all, is it really? And it was good. I really enjoyed it. There's nothing quite like being in a classroom full of young people, the buzz, the excitement, and the exhaustion afterwards. There is nothing like that. But I came away from that to go into pastoral church ministry, and that was not an easy decision because I loved teaching, but I think it was the right decision.
Wonderful. Okay, so next question is about sports. Now, Graham likes to play sports. Okay, hands up if you're a sports enthusiast. Anybody here like to play sports? Good, a few. All right. I don't know if you saw the way Graham walked up to the lectern here, so based on that, we're going to work out what sport has Graham been playing recently. Okay, was it A, rugby, B, golf, or C, hockey? So, well, Peter's keen there. Peter, you think you know. So, hands up for rugby. Who thinks this is a scrum half? Yeah, okay. Hands up for, what did I say B was? Golf. A bit of a swing. Am I just trying to throw you guys off the scent? You guys? And hands up, can you just say four for us?
Okay. Four.
Is that... convince anyone? Hands up for hockey.
Yes, of course, hockey. I'd never have survived this age playing rugby on YouTube. And I'm not sure I should really be playing hockey, but that's what I have been doing, and that's why I can't walk very well this morning.
Oh, no.
And do you still have all your own teeth?
I do, actually, yes. I've had a few broken fingers over the years, but my teeth are still intact.
Oh, broken fingers. Yeah, great. Okay, well, and what was your most recent victory with your hockey team?
Oh, my word. Okay, yes. 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago, yeah. Do you know, I think it might have been against Sonic.
Oh, no. Your team. I used to play for Sonic.
It was against Sonic.
Oh, sorry. Oh, dear. Oh, well, the door's over there. That's great. And so, Stan, so now you are down at... Southgate, do you want to tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, well, Calcott, Ford's Farm in Calcott, which is kind of next door to Southgate. But yeah, Kennet Valley Free Church, which has been there for about just over 40 years. I haven't been there quite that long. I've been there 23 years, though, so I'm ticking up the years. And lots of encouragements, not a few discouragements. Like for us all, it's been a tough time, hasn't it, these last couple of years. But they're a lovely group of people. I love them to bits, and they've put up with me for 23 years, so there must be something about them.
Wow.
That's special.
23 years. Hands up if you are younger than 23 years old. Clive, yeah. Wow. Okay, so this guy's been there preaching for longer than you guys have been alive. How about that? Wow. Okay, and you're going to be speaking to us from the book of Daniel this morning.
Yes, Daniel, which is a very exciting book. I'm going to look at a very exciting chapter that I'm going to concentrate on one verse, really. But it tells us that the Lord is ruling over all, which is always good to know.
That's fantastic. Graham, thanks so much. I'll invite you up again a little bit later. We're going to sing two more songs now. So remember, if you've got words that you haven't quite used in those first two songs, they'll probably be coming up in these songs that we're going to sing. So make sure if you've got one of those words, bring them up to the cross down here on the floor. And we're going to sing Mighty, Mighty Saviour and Jesus Strong and Kind. So again, if you want to pop your masks on and do stand up, and we'll sing those together.
You can walk.
Wonderful song we're singing about Jesus and all these words you brought up. So let's see if this works. Yeah, look at this. Well done, you guys. Look how wonderful that looks. So we've got Jesus, who's the King, he's the One, he's our Saviour, he's so good, he's the Promised One, he is faithful and he's with us, he's mighty, and he is our Lord, the Ruler, which is something Graham's going to be talking to us later. But what I want to do now is just use this to pray and thank God for all he's done for us. Shall we talk to God together now? Our Father, we thank you so much for this morning. We thank you for all the blessings that you've poured out on us over this week. Lord, you've held us and you've kept us. And we just want to say what a good God you are, and we love you. We thank you so much for sending Jesus into the world. Lord, Christmas is coming up. And it's the time when we remember when Jesus came down from heaven and walked on this earth as a man. And we thank you. We thank you for that. It has won us our freedom and has made us right with you when Jesus came and he died on that cross. And Lord, we're just lost for words. We want to be able to tell you just how much it means to us better. But Jesus, we thank you that you are the King. We thank you that you are so mighty. God, when we are weak, you are strong. And we do pray that you would help us. Lord, so many of us struggle through the week. It's been a tough week. But we thank you that you are strong and kind. And we can come to you and ask for your help. Jesus, we thank you that you are so faithful. Lord, all through this week, there have been times when we've run after other things, when we've forgotten about you. Lord, we are unfaithful, but you are so faithful. So we thank you again, our wonderful Saviour. We thank you that you died on the cross, that you made the way for us to be right with God. And we thank you that you are the King, the Ruler, the Lord, and that you hold everything in your hand. Lord, nothing surprises you. You know what's going to happen. You orchestrate. You command the ways of the world, Lord. You'll be bringing all things to fruition in your plan. One day, Jesus, you will return again. We look forward to that day. We thank you that although everything around us seems to change, seems to be so uncertain at the moment, especially, Lord, you are there. You are ruling and you are unchanging. So we thank you. And that you are the Son of God. And Jesus, we thank you. It took the Son of God to come down to rescue us. We thank you that you were prepared to do that, that you did it with gladness. And Lord, you saw everybody here and you loved them so much, you were prepared to die on the cross for them. The perfect Son of God, Jesus, the God-man. We just want to lift our hearts in praise to you. And Father, we thank you so much for Keith and Christine getting married. That's so exciting. Lord, we pray that you would bless them hugely in their marriage together. May they encourage each other to live for you. We thank you for the Wardridges and for little Pippa's baptism yesterday. Lord, we just want to pray blessings on Pippa. We ask that you'd grow her up to be a godly young lady, and that you would use her powerfully. Lord, we do ask that she'd come to know you from a young age, and we pray that for all our children here. Lord, we're so thankful for them. It's so great to see them all here, and we ask for your blessings on them. God, we're excited to hear what Graham's going to come and preach to us from your word, so we pray that you'd help us to be open and receptive as we open your word, that you would speak to our hearts. Lord, may the Spirit work through Graham powerfully this morning to be meeting us in our circumstance, and that you would work good in our lives this morning. Lord, you'd change us, we're really excited to hear that. So, Father, we just want to lift all these things to you. And praise your holy name, in Jesus' name, amen. So Graham is going to read it. It's Daniel chapter 5, so if you've got a Bible with you, do open it to Daniel chapter 5, and then Graham will read that passage and then preach to us from it.
Thanks so much, Graham. Daniel chapter 5.
Well, it's lovely to be here. Thanks for inviting me. And obviously, I've heard much about Christchurch Tarlhurst over the years. And it's good to actually be here in person. So that's great. I don't know I didn't ask, I'm sorry, what version you usually use here. But I have the New International Version here. So I hope that's okay. I'm reading from Daniel chapter 5. King Belshazzar gave a great banquet for 1,000 of his nobles and drank wine with them. While Belshazzar was drinking his wine, he gave orders to bring in the gold and silver goblets that Nebuchadnezzar, his father, had taken from the temple in Jerusalem, so that the king and his nobles, his wives, his concubines might drink from them. So these are special, holy goblets and things that used to be in the temple in Jerusalem, and they'd been brought to Babylon when Babylon had taken the people of Israel into captivity, and now they're going to drink from these goblets. As they drank the wine, they praised the gods of gold and silver, of bronze, iron, wood and stone. Suddenly, the fingers of a human hand appeared and wrote on the plaster of the wall near the lampstand in the royal palace. The king watched the hand as it rose. His face turned pale. He was so frightened that his legs became weak and his knees were knocking. And the king summoned the enchanters, astrologers, and diviners, and he said to the wise men of Babylon, "Whoever reads this writing and tells me what it means will be clothed in purple and have a gold chain placed round his neck, and he will be made the third highest ruler in the kingdom." Then all the king's wise men came in, but they could not read the writing or tell the king what it meant. So King Belshazzar became even more terrified, and his face grew more pale. His nobles were baffled. And the queen, hearing the voices of the king and his nobles, came into the banquet hall. "May the king live forever," she said. "Don't be alarmed. Don't look so pale. There is a man in your kingdom who has the spirit of the holy gods in him. In the time of your father, he was found to have insight and intelligence and wisdom like that of the gods. Your father, King Nebuchadnezzar, appointed him chief of the magicians, enchanters, astrologers, and diviners.
He did this because Daniel, whom the king called Belteshazzar, was found to have a keen mind and knowledge and understanding, and also the ability to interpret dreams, explain riddles, and solve difficult problems. Call for Daniel. He will tell you what the writing means. So Daniel was brought before the king. The king said to him, "Are you Daniel, one of the exiles my father the king brought from Judah? I've heard that the spirit of the gods is in you, and that you have insight, intelligence, and outstanding wisdom. The wise men and enchanters were brought before me to read the writing and tell me what it means, but they could not explain it. Now I have heard that you are able to give interpretations and to solve difficult problems. If you can read this writing and tell me what it means, you will be clothed in purple and have a gold chain placed around your neck, and you will be made the third highest ruler in the kingdom." And then Daniel answered the king, "You may keep your gifts for yourselves and give your reward to someone else. Nevertheless, I will read the writing for the king and tell him what it means. Your Majesty, the Most High God gave your father Nebuchadnezzar sovereignty and greatness and glory and splendor. Because of the high position he gave him, all the nations and peoples of every language dreaded and feared him. Those the king wanted to put to death, he put to death, and those he wanted to spare, he spared. Those he wanted to promote, he promoted, and those he wanted to humble, he humbled. But when his heart became arrogant and hardened with pride, he was deposed from his royal throne and stripped of his glory. He was driven away from people and given the mind of an animal. He lived with the wild donkeys and ate grass like the ox, and his body was drenched with the dew of heaven, until he acknowledged that the Most High God is sovereign over all kingdoms on earth and sets over them anyone he wishes. But you, Belshazzar, his son, have not humbled yourself, though you knew all this. Instead, you've set yourself up against the Lord of heaven. You had the goblets from his temple brought to you, and you and your nobles, your wives and your concubines, drank wine from them. You praised the gods of silver and gold, of bronze, iron, wood and stone, which cannot see or hear or understand, but you did not honor the God who holds in his hand your life and all your ways. Therefore, he sent the hand that wrote the inscription. And this is the inscription that was written, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Parsin. And here is what these words mean. Mene, God has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. Tekel, you have been weighed on the scales and found wanting. Perez, Parsin, your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians. And then at Belshazzar's command, Daniel was clothed in purple, a gold chain was placed round his neck, and he was proclaimed the third highest ruler in the kingdom. That very night, Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain, and Darius the Mede took over the kingdom at the age of 62. This is the word of the Lord. So today is the bid string. By the way, Jan, you get the prize for the first mention of Christmas up front that I've heard in the church. That's good to know. Today, October the 31st, called Halloween, All Hallows Eve, and it's the day when people focus on all kinds of scary things. You know what the scariest thing in the world is? It won't be mentioned in those Halloween parties and those Halloween costumes and all the rest of it. The scariest thing in the world is the judgment of God. That's the scariest thing in the world. And this story is about the judgment of God. We have Belshazzar's feast, and it's such a dramatic story with the hand appearing and writing on the wall. But, you know, it's one verse that I want to concentrate on, and it's one phrase, really, that I'm preaching on this morning. It's found in verse 11. The queen, possibly, this is actually the queen mother, that's Belshazzar's mum. It's possibly her, and she comes into the king, and she says, "There is a man. There is a man in your kingdom who has the spirit of the holy gods in him. In the time of your father Nebuchadnezzar, he was found to have insight and intelligence and wisdom like that of the gods. I noticed as we were reading it, he could explain riddles and solve difficult problems as well. That's amazing, isn't it? I bet he was a maths teacher. This woman comes and she says to the king, there is a man. Belshazzar is really shaken by this writing hand. Verse 6, it says, in the NIV, it says his face turned pale and he was so frightened that his legs became weak and his knees were knocking. I have to tell you, that's a little watered down. And I don't want to be out of place this morning, but the Authorized Version gets it a bit closer. And the Christian Standard Version, which is a more modern translation, that gets it more closer still, because you know what happens sometimes when people get really, really frightened? Children, you know what happens? Kind of lose control of your body. And you might wet yourself, or it might be even worse than that. And actually, the Christian Standard Version says the king soiled himself. It doesn't mean he went out in the garden and got dirty. It meant he pooed himself. That's what the Word of God says. That's how frightened he was. He was really, really scared. Really scared. And then the queen comes, the queen mother says, there is a man. There is a man. That's our first point. And that man is Daniel. A man with the spirit of the gods, with insight, intelligence, and wisdom like the gods. She says, he helped your father, Nebuchadnezzar. It's interesting that Belshazzar didn't seem to know about Daniel. At least he'd forgotten about Daniel. Daniel would have been about 80 by now, which is even older than me. And having attained that position of great power that he had, and great influence over in Nebuchadnezzar's day, where he really was, he was like Nebuchadnezzar's prime minister. Somehow he'd been shuffled off to obscurity, so much so that Belshazzar didn't even think of him. You might remember that Daniel was carried off into exile from Jerusalem at a very early age. I don't know how old, maybe 17 or 18, something like that. He was clearly a very gifted young man then. He was regarded as one of la crème de la crème, and he was fast-tracked in Babylonian society. He was groomed for great things. But he was a Jew. He was one of God's people. And here he was in exile, in a place that didn't recognize Israel's God, the Lord. They worshipped other gods. And the whole of the book of Daniel is about how can God's people possibly stay faithful to him in exile. After all, the very fact that Israel had, or Judah as it was then, the southern kingdom, had been defeated by Babylon, isn't that evidence that God, the Lord, the God of Israel, he'd lost, hadn't he? Weren't the Babylonian gods stronger? Hadn't they won? In which case, if you were taken into Israel as a Jew, you might say, well, why not worship these Babylonian gods instead? They looked stronger. If you can't beat them, join them. They'd be tempted to think that way, and I'm sure some Jews did go that way. But no, Daniel and his friends didn't do that. You can read about that in the first part of Daniel. Again and again, they find themselves in tricky situations, tricky positions. They've been given a top-notch Babylonian education. They've been lured just to fit in, just to assimilate with the culture around. And they do engage with society, with that culture, with the authorities as much as they can. They do serve where they can. They don't stay in a Jewish ghetto, not at all. But there's a line they don't cross. In chapter 1, you might remember Daniel insisting on not eating all that rich food. He was just going to eat vegetables instead of the impure food they were offered because of the role that food had in the worship of these pagan gods. In Daniel chapter 2, remember there's the vision of the statue, and Daniel speaks the truth to Nebuchadnezzar, even though that would be a very scary thing to do. He puts his life on the line and tells him the truth. In chapter 3, his three friends refuse to bow down to the statue and end up in the fiery furnace. Well, they don't end up there because God preserves them and brings them out. They say, we worship the Lord and him alone. And in so doing, they They risked their very lives. It was like a tightrope for these guys. They were walking a tightrope, engaging with society where they could, but being clear who they were following as they did so. They did use their gifts for the benefit of their conquerors. That was a gracious thing to do, really. It's interesting, God had sent a message to Jeremiah, to these people in exile, and he told them to seek the welfare of the city. You can read that in Jeremiah 29. Verse 7, seek the welfare of Babylon. They're to work for Babylon's good, even though Babylon didn't care about their God and had taken them into exile. They were still to do good in the place where they were. They were even given Babylonian names, and even those names actually referenced Babylonian gods. So these Jews, they were engaging positively with society wherever they could. And they were being honoured and respected for that. But when the question became, who do you really serve? They had to stand firm. And they made it clear who they were following. They were following the one true God, the Lord of Israel. Truly, they were living in the Babylonian world, but they were not of the Babylonian world. Now, how could they manage this? How could they manage to walk this tightrope? Well, the book of Daniel gives us one reason, and it gives us this reason again and again. They may be in exile, but the Lord God of Israel is still the king of all the earth. He reigns in Babylon just as much as he reigns in Jerusalem. It may not look like it, but that's the truth. He reigns over Babylon. He is king. He is sovereign. He is in charge, not the Babylonian gods. And so they don't exist, the Babylonian gods. They are no gods, actually. But the one true God, he is real and he is reigning. And so as they stand firm and as they trust in the Lord, so they were rescued, they were vindicated, they were lifted up and shown to be in the right. And this pagan queen, Belshazzar's mum, we think, well, she remembers this. She remembers a man who can help, a man with real insight, real wisdom. What was his secret? Well, she puts it like this. He has the spirit of the holy gods on him. Well, she was nearly right. It is the spirit of just one God, the one true God, that Daniel had in him. And so Daniel is called and he speaks truth to power, which must have been taken some nerve to this presumably drunken and Larry King, scared out of his mind. But the king hears this message of judgment, and it is just a message of judgment, isn't it? Belshazzar, you've not acknowledged God, your days are up. That's it. There's no grace and mercy there, actually. It's just judgment. And he hears that, and he even rewards Daniel for it, though Daniel tells him to keep his reward. Maybe Daniel is thinking, well, if this is going to come to pass, then the honour of Belshazzar won't be worth much come the morning. Daniel weighed correctly the transience of human reward, didn't it? He knew that does not last. But in all of this, Daniel was faithfully carrying out the role given not just to him, but actually given to the whole of Israel, the whole of God's people, because God had called them. God had chosen them. He'd chosen them not to just enjoy a cozy, exclusive relationship with him while the rest of the world goes their own sweet way. He called them, he says in the Bible, to be a light to the nations, to shine out God's light to the nations by their lifestyle, through their worship of the one true God, to show the character of that God to the nations around. That was the great calling of Israel, shining the light of the Lord into a dark pagan world. This is what Daniel is doing. This is what Daniel does here. But of course we know that Israel as a whole and as a nation actually failed to carry out that role faithfully. That's why they're in exile. They failed to do it consistently. So did God's purposes for Israel fail then? Well, no, because we can say today that there is a man, and he is Jesus. That's our second point. There is a man and he is Jesus. In Luke chapter 4, when Jesus picks up that scroll in the synagogue, he reads out, he quotes from Isaiah. He picks up the scroll of Isaiah and he reads out, and the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he said, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. Jesus fulfills that scripture. Jesus fulfills the calling of Israel. That quotation is from Isaiah. But here comes Jesus fulfilling this calling where Israel failed, to shine a light in the darkness, just as John says, which verse I'm sure will crop up in our Christmas celebrations, John chapter 1, verse 5, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. It's the light of Jesus. Here is a man, Jesus, in exile, just as Daniel was in exile. He'd left his father's throne, but into exile he brings the wisdom of the Lord, just as Daniel did. More than Daniel did, of course. Daniel did it to some measure. Jesus brings that to fulfillment. Of course, the world did not understand him. And just as later in chapter 6 of Daniel, Daniel gets thrown in the lion's den, so Jesus, as Daniel goes down into the pit, so Jesus has to go down into the grave. And just as Daniel was delivered by the Lord, he was kept safe and rescued and lifted up out of the lion's den. What a wonderful picture of resurrection that is. Because Jesus was raised up by God, his own Father, whom he trusted. He was lifted up in vindication. Jesus' words, John tells us, Jesus' words, Jesus was full of grace and truth. That's a wonderful combination, isn't it? Daniel's words to Belshazzar, well, we've said they were really, it was just a message of pure judgment. There was no option given to Belshazzar to repent and he'd be okay. God's patience with Belshazzar had already been stretched too far. Jesus comes. Yes, he does speak judgment, especially to those who are leading the God's people astray. But there is grace. There's grace for those who listen and turn. And look where Jesus goes. He doesn't stay in the safe places. He doesn't stay in the ghetto. He goes to the sinners. He goes to the outsiders. He goes to the sick who need a doctor, as he puts it. And of course, he goes to the cross. Death, the ultimate place of exile. Because we all need a doctor. That's why he went. But with the Spirit upon him, Jesus speaks words of grace, words of liberation. Now, of course, Daniel was just a man, and Jesus was the eternal Son of God. But it was the same Spirit upon Jesus as was upon Daniel. Daniel had the Spirit in measure, not fully. Jesus was fully led by the Spirit of God, filled by the Spirit. But it's the same Spirit. And it's the same Spirit that is poured out at Pentecost on all who believe in Jesus. So what about now? What about now in our own time, in our own place? Well, even today, in this day and age, we can say our third point, there is a man, there is a woman, there is a child. Those who believe in Jesus. Let me tell you a story about two camels. And it's a daddy camel and a son camel. And the son is at the inquisitive stage. He's full of questions. And so he says to his dad, he says, Dad.
Yes, son.
Why have we got this great big hump on our backs? Well, son, says the father, that's because when you're in that hump can store water and fat so that when we're in the desert, we can survive for days and days and days without being, without getting any food or water. That's a great thing. So the son thinks a bit longer and he says, Dad, why have we got such big flat feet? Well, son, says the camel, that's because when we're in the desert, with flat feet like that, our weight can get spread out across the feet so that we don't sink into the sand when we walk, so we can walk in the desert. Ah, he says, thinks a bit more, he says, so Dad, yes, son, why have we got squinty little eyes and big eyelashes? Because that's when in the desert the sandstorm comes, we can kind of squint up our eyes, and the lashes keeps the grain of sand out of our eyes so that we can survive in the sandstorms in the desert. Ah, says the son. And he thinks a bit longer, and then he turns to his dad and he says, so Dad, son, really, you could say we are fully equipped for life in the desert. Yes, son, that's right, says the father. Son takes a finger and then says, so Dad, yes, son, what are we doing in London Zoo? When we ourselves put our faith in Jesus, that same spirit that was upon Daniel and was upon Jesus unites us to Jesus. That same spirit that was upon them comes and lives in us too, which means we are equipped. Equipped not for a life in a cozy place where there is no problems, equipped for life in a difficult world, equipped for life in exile. And that is where we're living. You remember Jesus said to his followers, you are the light of the world. Now, Jesus was the light of the world. He says to his followers, you are the light of the world, because they're called to shine out the light. In Philippians 2, verse 15, we read, do everything without grumbling or arguing, so you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky. As we trust in Christ, as with his spirit upon us, so we take up that mantle of being lights to the world. We are taking up the mantle of bringing God's wisdom to bear, just like Daniel. Yes, we feel like exiles in this world, but we're called to engage whilst living holy lives. We are called to walk that tightrope, and it's difficult. We may well want to retreat, to stay in the Christian ghetto, to only have Christian friends and to only mix with Christians. We may want to stay silent when people are saying things around us. But God wants other people who do not know him to be able to think of us and say, when they're puzzled, when they're struggling, when life is hard for them to say, there is a man, there is a woman, there is a child. Someone I know at my workplace, up my road, in my class at school, who I can trust and who I can talk to recognize God's wisdom in us and his peace, and of course his loving care and concern. That's what he's equipped us for. Like those camels, by God's spirit we are equipped not to live in the Christian zoo, but to live in the spiritual deserts of this world. To live in exile where God isn't recognized. But as we live there, we point to his kingdom, just as Daniel did. So what about your situation? It's something to pray for, that you will be known as someone with wisdom and insight. Someone who can read the writing on the wall for your generation in your place. Whether it's your family or your workplace or your friends, you have the same spirit. You can pray for that. Speaking truth to power and influence, yes. But speaking love and grace too. Showing love and grace. Not just declaiming from the sidelines, but actively involved. It's interesting in this time of plague. During the times of plague in the 17th century, many Puritans were very clear in their own understanding that this was a judgment from God. And yet, at the same time, it was so often the Puritans who risked their own health and their own lives by getting alongside and caring for those who were suffering. They did not stay at a distance. And what an example that is for us. You can build positively for God's kingdom values, knowing as surely as Daniel did, that despite what it may look like. Your God is king. He is ruling. His kingdom will last, while other kingdoms, yes, other fashionable opinions, they will fall, they will fail. Not just your lips, but your lives will speak both judgment and grace. And that's true, isn't it? When we speak and when we act, we do show up judgment too, because people will look at us and they might feel a bit condemned and they might feel a bit guilty. And when you don't lie in your workplace just because it's convenient to do so, when you don't just push people aside in your workplace, when you don't gossip, when you don't slander, people will notice and people might feel a bit awkward about that because it shows up their lives in contrast. But always, we're to be seasoned with grace, showing with our lives that we love and we care and we value, because we know the God of love, who longs to save us. Let me just close with this true story of a woman who, in our fellowship, she became a Christian, in her 30s maybe, and her extended family, they were not Christians at all, so she endured quite a lot of mocking because she came to the Lord. And she knew she was going away for a holiday with various different parts of her extended family, different, you know, bits, arms of the family getting together. And it was something they'd done for many years, this half term. And it would end with a big Halloween party, October 31st. And they would all dress up and they'd have a great Halloween celebration. And now as a Christian, she was really concerned about that. What was she going to do? She felt that she no longer wanted to celebrate all that darkness and things associated with spirits and so forth. But at the same time, she didn't just want to opt out. She knew if she just opted out, her family would say, "Oh, now you're a Christian. You're just a party pooper." She didn't want to do that. And she wanted to spend time with them. She wanted to engage with them. So she came to us and she talked about this. And we discussed it with her and we prayed with her. And we didn't give her any answers really. But we did talk about it. And she went away and we prayed for her. And she prayed and she thought about it. She came back to us a couple of days later. And she said, "I've got it. I know what I'm going to do." And she said, "I'm going to go to that party. And I'm going to dress up as a candle. And people will ask me, 'Why are you dressed up as a candle?' And I will say, 'Because I believe in Jesus, the light of the world, who shines into all this darkness.'" It's wonderful. Brilliant. That was what she did. And she was God's woman in that time, for that party. She was there, testifying to him, pointing to him, witnessing to him. At that party, there was a woman, God's woman, pointing clearly to Christ. And so it is wherever you are, wherever you go out through this week, there is a man, there's a woman, there is a child. And if you're trusting in the Lord, it is you. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for Daniel, this man of courage and this man of great faith. But we thank you more for you, the God of Daniel, you yourself, who is sovereign over his life, even at that difficult time. And we thank you for how Daniel points us towards Jesus himself in all his glory, who knew the spirit of wisdom on him, the spirit of the Lord, in full as the eternal Son of God. But thank you that he has poured out his spirit on us who believe. And that you call us into the hard places of the world, wherever we go this week, which may well be a hard place. We go with you. We may feel ourselves to be in exile, but you are with us, and you are still the Lord over all, and we can point to you. Help us to do that, Lord, we pray. Amen. Amen. So let's sing as we close. O church, arise and put your arm on. Oh, church.
Graham, thank you so much. It was a real encouragement to us. And bless you guys as you go out this week. Father, we thank you so much. And we want to praise you with our whole lives. So we ask you to fill us with your spirit so that we would become your men, your women, and boldly proclaim the gospel. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.